The next item of business is consideration of business motion 14730 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to business. Any member who wishes to speak to the motion should press their request to speak button, and I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak to the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 14730 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions. At question number one, I call Jackie Bailey.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to council leaders withdrawing support for its National Care Service Bill.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The National Care Service is about improving lives and ending the inconsistency of care provision across Scotland. Reform is needed. Derek Feely's recommendations were clear. The thousands of people we've spoken to who receive or provide care agree. So it is disappointing that COSLA has taken this step. We have worked extensively with them on their concerns for almost 2 years and made a series of changes, substantial changes, at their request. Uppermost in our minds, and I'm sure theirs, is the need of the people who rely on care services. And in that spirit, we will continue to work with individual councils and, where they are willing, COSLA on these matters, as well as colleagues across this chamber. In the meantime, we will continue working to invest in and improve social care services in Scotland.
Jackie Bailey.
The bill doesn't actually resemble the recommendations of the Feely Review. And the truth is that the withdrawal from COSLA follows the withdrawal of all three social care trade unions, the GMB, Unite and Unison, and it comes in the face of criticism from NHS chief executives and board chairs, and clear disappointment from the third sector as to the lack of vision. The substance of the bill is to create another quango, which is not expected to be established until 2028 or 2029. It does nothing to improve social care just now. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, does he agree with his predecessor and former employer, Alex Neil, when he says this is a nonsensical bill, and will he pause stage two to take the time to get this right?
Cabinet Secretary.
The areas that Jackie Bailey covered there, the first part was around the recommendations of Feely, and the reason why there has been a departure from that is because of the work that we have done with COSLA in order to find a compromise position that would allow us to move forward, which is why I say that I am more than a little disappointed in the fact that we've arrived in the position that we did on Friday, because we reached agreement on the vast majority of issues that have been worked through on a tripartite basis in order to make progress, because I think we're all in agreement that there needs to be reform. It's what that reform looks like that's going to be important, and why I'm committed to still maintaining dialogue, not just with local authority leaders, but also with colleagues across Parliament. But the reason that some elements of the amendments that were before stage two were also paused was also at the request of COSLA, those around children and justice, around direct funding, and around the removal of board members. Those discussions had not started up again, so I'm more than disappointed that they arrived at that position Friday before concluding those discussions.
Thank you, Bailey.
No doubt that you would want to talk to COSLA, but I don't think you've actually been listening to them. The Scottish Government has revealed that it is spending almost £1 million a month on civil servants working on the bill. Over £2 million has been spent on private sector consultants. The cost to date has been well over £10 million, and all we have to show is botched legislation that very few support, and that will not make a difference to social care now. At the same time, care packages are being cut, direct payments are being slashed, services are being removed, and staff are leaving. Councillor Chris Cunningham has appealed to the SNP government for help to fill the £112 million black hole in the health and social care budget for Glasgow. This is the story in health and social care partnerships across Scotland. So what will the Cabinet Secretary do to help social care right now before it runs into more difficulty?
Cabinet Secretary.
So there's a number of areas in there in Jackie Bailey's question. The first element around our interactions with COSLA, we've agreed that local government would retain existing statutory responsibility, staff, assets, functions. There would be no removal of functions from local authorities. We've agreed to reform the existing integration joint boards instead of introducing new local care boards. The National Care Service Board is a partnership, and we agreed with local government that they would be part of that partnership, not subordinate. It is not a ministerial board, it's a joint board. So we have been listening to COSLA. We've acted on their ask, including on pausing those elements of the bill that we ended up, but that we have had still got areas to agree upon. So that's why Friday's decision, I believe, was preemptive, because we still had areas to conclude on. In terms of what we're doing now, because I think Jackie Bailey is absolutely right, this is about how we improve social care experiences for those that work in it and that receive services now. We've achieved our target of increasing social care spending 2 years early, and we'll continue to work with partnerships on improving the picture of regards like delayed discharge and other areas, as we've been doing in the summer, so that we can see discernible progress and improvement for the people who need and expect our services to reform and improve.
Hugh Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There's a broad agreement that there is a need for reform in social care to ensure there are consistent standards across the country. So it's very disappointing that there are after a considerable period of hard work to find consensus, some now appear to be playing politics and are now refusing to work together. Mm-hmm. So will the Cabinet Secretary join me in calling on everyone involved to get back round the table and to work together so we can deliver the vital reform to social care and community health that we all know is needed to meet the current and future needs of people across Scotland?
Yep. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Jackie Dunbar for that question. Yes, I do. The intention for a National Care Service and this bill, I reiterate, is about improving people's lives and the quality of care, and it's not about party politics. It is crucial that we continue to ensure that people who use or work in the social care, social work, community health care services are at the heart of our reforms. They have told us time and again that the system needs fundamental and sustainable change. So many stakeholders remain committed to work together for the people that they serve. For example, this morning the Health Committee heard from NHS leaders who reiterated their willingness to achieve these aims. And we will continue to work with individual councils. The door is open should COSLA wish to engage too.
Ms White.
Cabinet Secretary, despite councils withdrawing support and NHS chief executives blasting the SNP's proposals, this government continues to push forwards with their unpopular and unworkable plan for a centralised care service. £28.7 million has already been spent this session and on work relating to the National Care Service. The care sector, is, as we've heard, is on its knees. When will the Cabinet Secretary commit to directing future funding to improve social care now, instead of continuing on with this disastrous policy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we are doing that already. We have met our target 2 years early of increasing our investment in social care. So that ask from Tess White is already underway. In terms of where NHS chief executives and chairs are, she'll have heard at the Health Committee this morning them saying that they agree with the premise of the National Care Service and the direction of travel, the aims that we're attempting to go on. We will work with anybody who is looking to take forward the National Care Service in a way that ensures we improve the situation for those in receipt of social care and, critically, those who work within it, because we need to improve those standards and provide greater consistency for them both.
Willie Rennie.
The Cabinet Secretary has just said that they've increased investment in social care. In Fife this week, they're cutting support in half for respite care, and they're cutting care packages by £5 million. So they're reducing the expenditure, not increasing. Meanwhile, his bill that's supposed to solve all of this in 2028 is losing supporters by the day. When will the minister understand this is not the answer? He needs to focus on the fundamentals of social care designed to help vulnerable people and the NHS. That's what we need, not this bill.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, with respect to Willie Rennie, I think those in receipt of social care would disagree with him. And there are many who have provided evidence on the bill who say that this is the way forward to provide consistency, both for those in receipt of social care and those who are working with them. It's a fact that we've increased investment in social care. It's there for all to see. I'm conscious of the decisions that have been made within partnerships across the country, which is why we've been engaging over the summer around the picture on delayed discharge to try to make sure that we have a prioritisation of social care to improve the situation on delayed discharge. Unfortunately, some decisions are making that more difficult.
Question number two, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it will ensure that pensioners can afford to heat their homes this winter.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley Ann Somerville.
Pension age winter heating payment will support older people on relevant benefits to help meet heating costs this winter. Winter heating payment guarantees a reliable annual payment of £58.75, only available to Scotland, and that's for people on low incomes, including older people. Our energy efficiency programmes, Warmer Homes Scotland and area-based schemes provide vital support to households in or at risk of fuel poverty. And this year alone, we're spending £134 million to mitigate UK government policies through schemes such as discretionary housing payments and the Scottish Welfare Fund, providing vital support to households struggling to meet housing and energy costs.
Liam Kerr.
Well, new research has revealed that rural households endure more cold weather than any other part of Scotland. Yet, the winter heating payment that the Cabinet Secretary referred to previously, and in the rest of the UK still, is assessed from data from the nearest weather station. It's worth £150 in Aboyne, £175 in Braemar and Inverness, £150 in Aviemore in 2020. This year, as we heard, it's capped at a flat rate of £58.75. by the Scottish Government. Cabinet Secretary, why did the Scottish Government choose to centralise this and ignore local weather data? And will the Government consider reverting to a fairer system based on local weather conditions to bring the people of rural Scotland back in from the cold?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Mr Kerr will be very cognisant of the consultation which was undergone at the time. And can I point Mr Kerr to the facts when it comes to actually what happened in the past and contrast that to the current situation with the winter heating payment? Forecasts indicate that we'll invest £24.4 million this winter for winter heating payment. Now, that's nearly tripling the £8.5 million that was provided on average by the DWP in each of the last 7 years prior to the introduction of the new winter heating payment. So what Mr Kerr is failing to recognise is the fact that the decisions made by the Scottish Government will guarantee people a support this year, which I think will be more than welcome given other announcements by the UK Government. And it is very important that that reassurance is there and that guaranteed payment is there. And the demonstration on the difference that it will make, Presiding Officer, is very clear in that investment that we will make, much more than the DWP bid. And that's why we're investing more in social security, because it's an investment in our people.
Liam Kerr.
Well, that'll be cold comfort for those in the North East losing over £100 this year. But in other areas, pensioners throughout Scotland are also faced with the Scottish Government's choice to end the winter fuel payment for many of them. The cost of maintaining it would be £140 million. Now, the Scottish Government could have chosen to fund this by using some of the £2 billion projected cost of the National Care Service, but it chooses not to. Cabinet Secretary, why does the SNP choose to fund pet projects rather than help pensioners freezing in their homes this winter?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I hope Mr Kerr was listening to the answers that my colleague Neil Gray gave, the National Care Service is about providing better services for people here in Scotland. And I don't recognise the figures that he has illustrated in his question. And he also is absolutely choosing to ignore the fact that the decision that was made by the UK Government took £150 million out of the budget this year. not over the coming years, this year. So that is £150 million this year, £150 million the next year, and on and on and on. And I am sick and tired, Presiding Officer, of the hypocrisy from opposition members who think that the position of the Scottish Government is to mitigate against the UK Government and their bad choices.
Yeah. Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. During the election campaign, Labour promised to cut fuel bills. Instead, energy bills are increasing by 10% and they've withdrawn the winter fuel payment from millions of pensioners, a move rejected by their own party membership. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that Labour's broken promises are shameful, and can she give me more detail on the Scottish Government's work with energy firms to deliver a social tariff?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Colette Stevenson is quite right to point out to members of this chamber and indeed those across the country the real difference that Labour are making, the change that they have brought in. They promised to reduce and cut fuel bills, and actually this very day people are seeing their fuel bills going up this winter. I'm not sure that's the change people had in mind, Presiding Officer. But given that is the circumstances that we face ourselves, the Scottish Government is not only looking to see what it can be done within the powers and the resources that we have, but we're also very keen to work with energy providers. And Colette Stevenson mentions a very, very important example of that. That social tariff would provide affordable energy tariffs that should be automatically applied to those most in need. Now, we need the UK Government to work with us and energy companies on that, but in the meantime, we are establishing a working group to work with those energy companies to be able to provide demonstration of the viability of a social tariff, and I hope the UK Government could commit to taking this forward.
Paul O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary could explain why, prior to any UK election, this government chose to cut the Household Insecurity Fund, repeatedly cut energy efficiency budgets, and have left two-thirds of houses in Scotland to fall below the recommended energy efficiency standards. It would also be useful for the Chamber if they could understand why her SNP colleagues in Westminster failed to vote to deliver a GB energy bill, which will deliver lower energy bills in the longer term, and invest in that change we so badly need.
Cabinet Secretary, on matters for which the Scottish Government has responsibility.
Well, we are very keen, as the First Minister said last week, to work with GB Energy, but let's be very clear. GB Energy are not cutting people's household bills this winter or indeed for the next winters. This is a mid to long term project, and we're very keen to work with GB Energy on that. Mr O'Kane is again, choosing, Presiding Officer, to ignore the investment that we do give to older people, whether that's on the winter heating payment, whether that's on the council tax reduction scheme, the free bus travel for anyone aged over 60, supporting older people's organisations, the advice services that were there to help people get what they're entitled to, the Warmer Homes Scotland and Area-Based Initiative, the Islands Cost Crisis Emergency Fund. We are doing what we can, Presiding Officer, to support not just pensioners, but those suffering from fuel poverty. It's just a shame that there is one of the governments that are responsible for Scotland that are actually making that harder and putting people into poverty this winter rather than lifting them out.
Yeah. Emma Harper.
Labour's decision to cut the winter heating payment for many pensioners will disproportionately impact older people in Scotland. The temperature variation in Scotland is significantly different to areas south of the border, with the temperature on Monday being 10 degrees in Wanlick Head and 16 degrees in London. This cut will hit older people in rural areas who, and some of them rely on oil-fuelled heating, such as 30% of the homes in D&G, which currently do. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that this cut should be reversed? And could you comment any further on action that the Scottish Government is taking to support older people this winter?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I've mentioned in some of my previous answers, Presiding Officer, the support that we continue to give to older people, and we will do so despite the budget cuts that seem to be coming our way. But Emma Harper's quite right to point out that Labour can still reverse the decision that they have taken on winter fuel payment. That opportunity still lies in their hands. And that's why I've written to the Secretary of State for Work and Pensions following the publication of the UK Government's winter fuel payments equality analysis, calling for her to reinstate winter fuel payment for all pensioners. That's the right thing to do, Presiding Officer, and I hope if she doesn't listen to me, or indeed to this wider chamber, then she certainly listens to pensioners up and down the country that we will continue to support as they face a very difficult winter.
And Ash Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Government advise how many Scottish pensioners are now excluded from winter fuel payments in 24-25? And also, what assurances have the Scottish Government had from the UK Government that a mass media pension credit claim campaign will increase uptake for eligible claimants before the December 21st pension credit cut-off period to enable them to qualify for winter fuel payment?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government analysis suggests that between 110,000 and 130,000 pensioners will remain eligible for payment in Scotland this winter. That represents a reduction of around 900,000 pensioners who will no longer be entitled this winter. The requirement, the obligation of the UK Government to have a benefit uptake campaign is absolutely critical, and I have again written to the Secretary of State as soon as this decision was announced by the UK Government to encourage her to do that. We've seen some progress on that. And indeed, although this is a reserve benefit, the agencies here in Scotland, including Social Security Scotland, are keen and are working with the DWP to try and amplify that message still further.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions. I'll allow a moment or two for front benches to organise for the next item.